I love bread. There, I said it. I admit it. I love bread. And that is why it pains me that medieval manuscripts rarely talk about bread. It's probably because they were written by cooks for cooks rather than bakers, but I wish that we had actual contemporary bread recipes from the time. But the Harleian manuscript, 279, does have one. Now, it's a 15th century recipe for something called brede en restant, or bread and rastons. I don't know how to pronounce it, probably restant, you know, it still had a lot of French influence, plus I think it sounds fancy. Anyway, today I'm going to teach you how to make your own restant at home and let you decide that age-old question which has broken up many a family: is a restant bread or is it pastry? This time on Tasting History. Now, I've put the original 15th century recipe in the description below, but it's kind of in a Middle English dialect, so good luck with that, though you can actually get most of it, which is kind of cool. But I'm also going to give you some of the highlights right now, in modern English. Take fair flour and the white of egg and a little yolk, then take warm barm and put these together until the dough is crumbly. Cast sugar into it and let it rest a while. Then place it in an oven and let it bake. Then cut the top crust in the shape of a crown, put clarified butter inside, and stir the crumbs and butter together. Cover it with the crust you cut away and put it in the oven again, then take it out and serve it forth. So as far as medieval recipes go, this is pretty darn good. You know, it doesn't have exact measurements or bake times or anything like that, but they never do. But in essence, it gives you everything you need to know, so good job, medieval scribe.
Thank you.
But here's the question. With all of that sugar and butter and egg, is this a pastry or is it bread? Now, the term pastry was not something really used in the Middle Ages to refer to pastry as we think of it today. Pastry simply referred to the shell of a pie or tart, and that was it. But by today's standards, some people would actually call this a pastry. So, I mean, I honestly don't know. Until I taste it, I'm not going to really be able to make an informed opinion. But if you have a strong opinion either way, please let me know in the comments, either now or whenever you make it at home. But I digress. Let's get to the ingredients. First, fair flour. We're going to use 450 grams. Now, fair flour is not the same as processed, bleached, all-white, all-purpose flour that we have today, but it's actually not that far off in comparison with some of the other flours that were used at the time. It's finely ground, well-sifted wheat flour, and it's basically the closest thing that you're going to get to modern all-purpose flour, but really, it's not the same. So I'm actually using about half all-purpose flour mixed with half stone-ground whole wheat flour, and, you know, that's what it's gonna be. But if you have all-purpose flour, if you can find flour at this point in quarantine, whatever you got, it's good to use. And we're gonna come back to flour later when we put on our history hats. I don't know what that looks like. Is it a crown or maybe that like Mickey sorcerer's hat? I need a history hat. Next, it calls for white of egg and a little yolk. So we're going to use 2 egg whites and 1 yolk. And I'm actually going to use that second yolk, since we have it and I hate wasting things, to brush on the top of the loaves at the very end before we pop them in the oven, just to give it some kind of dark sheen, make them pretty. But that is a Max Miller edition, so don't feel that you need to do it. Then we get to the tricky part. It calls for warm barm. Now, if you make your own beer at home, or if you have access to a brewery that is willing to sell it to you, good on you, use about 1 cup of warm ale barm. But if you don't, we're going to make our own or something akin to it here. So what you're going to need is 1 cup of warm ale, English ale, whatever you got, and a packet or about 7 or 8 grams of dried yeast. So you want that ale to be above room temperature, maybe like 90 to 100 degrees, and you're going to take that yeast and pour it on in and mix it up. Then let it sit for about 10 minutes to get nice and foamy. Finally, we need a little bit of sugar. Now, it said cast some sugar on it. How much sugar is it? I don't know. We're gonna use 2 tablespoons of brown sugar, but you can use a little bit more, you can use a little bit less, totally up to you. Then 1 stick or 113 grams of butter. Now, the recipe does not call for salt, but they often would leave things like that out of old recipes, and salt is just a common thing in bread, so I'm actually going to throw 1 teaspoon of salt in there as well. You can, you cannot, it's up to you. Nobody's looking. Now, after about 10 minutes, your faux barm or ale yeast concoction should be nice and foamy, at which point you can go ahead and mix it with the 2 egg whites and 1 yolk. Then toss in the sugar and mix that in. It doesn't need to dissolve, just kind of break it up. Then sift your flour into a bowl and whisk in the salt if you're going to use it. You want to mix it in because if it touches the yeast directly, bad things happen. Now the original recipe says this dough should be short or crumbly, like short bread, that's where the term comes from, which is a hallmark of a pastry. But it also needs to rise like bread, meaning like you need to really work the gluten and be able to get a bit of a stretch in it, which is a hallmark of a bread. So here we are again, no further along in our quest. So mix all the ingredients up together in the bowl, and as it kind of comes together to form a crumbly dough, you're going to put it out onto a lightly floured surface and knead it. Now, you can use a stand mixer, but this is actually a pretty easy one to knead by hand. So if you've ever wanted to knead a dough by hand, this is your time. Once it's nice and smooth, after about 10 minutes of hand kneading or 4 or 5 minutes in a mixer, you're going to cover it and let it rise for about an hour or until it doubles in size. Now, while that rises, let's take a look at that main ingredient, the fair flour. You might remember if you watched the Trencher episode, I'll put a link up on one of these sides. The Trencher episode, we talked about lots of different flours that were used in medieval Europe, mainly medieval England. Oat and barley and rye and even flour made of dried peas. These were the flours of the masses. But we are wealthy. Not really. But today we're wealthy. So we are going to enjoy fair flour, which is wheat flour. Wheat. The loveliest corn men eat. That was 13th century moralist and didactic poet William de Waddington. What he's referring to is what corn should be used to make communion wafers, because you want them to be made out of the best. Well, that's going to be white refined wheat flour. And by corn, I mean any grain, because until relatively recently, like 200 years ago, corn basically referred to grain in general. So dear de Waddington's observation about wheat being the proper corn for communion wafers also extended to other breads. And, you know, wheat was the corn of the upper crust. It could be refined into a pale white powder that was very high in gluten, which gave bread a wonderful rise, which is probably why Scarface was so in love with it. Anyway, it was prized, but the men that made it, the millers, my stock, they were not always the most liked people in town, and frankly, it was dangerous to make. So let's take a look at what made bringing flour to the people so darn hard. Let us start with Geoffrey Chaucer. It's a very good place to start. Mr. Chaucer does not depict millers in the best of light. Now, each individual character in the Canterbury Tales is individual, but they also kind of represent the zeitgeist of medieval society. And like I said, millers, not loved. The miller in the Canterbury Tales is a man who tells dirty stories, starts fights, and breaks through doors with his head. He has a wart on the end of his nose, bristled with red hair like the kind that grows out of a pig's ear. This is not exactly a glowing Tinder profile. But where Chaucer reflects the true feelings most people had about millers in the Middle Ages is when he says, in modern English, a thief he was, it's true, of corn and meal, and sly at that, accustomed well to steal. He also mentions the miller as having a thumb of gold, which is probably an ironic comment on the old adage, an honest miller hath a golden thumb, meaning that they usually had a heavy thumb when it came to weighing their product, i.e., my ancestors were thieves, I guess. Go figure. And if you think it's just Chaucer ragging on my relatives, you would be wrong. Because around the same time, John Lydgate, in his ballad Thievish Millers and Bakers, suggests that millers and bakers should build their guilds right beneath the pillory, because that's where they usually end up anyway. Makes for a short trip, I guess. He even says that if they're repeat offenders, they should be killed. Wow. And did I mention that Lydgate was a monk at Bury St. Edmunds? So if you don't even have monks on your side, yeesh. Though I think my favorite little tidbit about Brother Lydgate was actually an 18th century poet commenting on his works. Joseph Ritson said that Lydgate was a voluminous, prosaic, and driveling monk. Whew, that hurts. But not as much as losing a hand. And a lot of millers lost hands. That's right. Not only were millers not appreciated, but they also had to work in conditions that were less than OSHA approved. Last summer, I visited the Winchester City Mill. It's the oldest working water mill in England, and something has been on that spot making flour since the 10th century. And while I was there, I was privileged enough to watch them actually feed some corn or grain into a chute that went down to the millstones where it was ground into flour. Of course, now they have lots of protective equipment around these millstones, but back in the Middle Ages, there wasn't anything there. So these two millstones that can weigh between a ton and a ton and a half and rotate against each other at up to 120 RPM, they were just out in the open. So if you accidentally got a hand or even some clothing caught between these millstones, you were screwed. Even worse was the series of cogs and wheels all around the building that turned these millstones. I mean, they were just open and such a disaster waiting to happen. But let's say that you were lucky enough to be safe at all times and not lose an appendage, and you made some wonderful fine flour, so fine that the dust of it puffed up into the air, creating a bit of a cloud. Well, don't light a candle, because you might explode. That's right, probably the most dangerous part about being a miller throughout history, not just the Middle Ages, but throughout history, has been the fact that they're grinding carbohydrates, which is carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, extremely flammable things, into a fine powder all around them. And they would sometimes touch a spark or a flame and blow up. And like I said, this is throughout all history. This is not just the Middle Ages. On the evening of May 2nd, 1878, the Washburn A Mill in Minneapolis, then the largest mill in the world, exploded, sending a fireball hundreds of feet into the air, killing 14 workers. Turns out that two of the millstones, grinding against each other, got hot and let off a spark, which ignited the flour, which created a chain reaction. There goes the whole building. But you're saying, well, that's the 19th century. Things are very different. No. I mean, yes, I'm sure it's a lot safer now, but it's something that still can occur. I found several examples from the 1980s. It's not easy being a miller. But frankly, in the Middle Ages, it wasn't really easy being anyone unless you were the king. Because the king got to eat Restant, which is what we're about to do. So it's good to be the king. So once your dough is risen, punch it down and turn it out onto a lightly floured surface. Then you can divide it up into whatever size loaf you want. I'm gonna make three separate loaves, but you could do six and they'd be like little rolls, or you can do one big loaf, totally up to you. The bake times are gonna be about the same. But regardless of how many loaves you make, the recipe says that you're going to cut the top into the shape of a crown, so I assume that means round. So make round loaves. So shape the loaves and then set them onto a lined baking sheet and cover loosely and let them rest for 20 to 30 minutes while you turn on that oven to 400 degrees Fahrenheit or 200 degrees Celsius. After about 20 minutes, the loaf should be nice and puffy, and here is where, if you want, you can use that optional egg yolk and give it a nice beat, add a little bit of water if it's too thick, like mine was, and then brush the tops of the loaves and they'll be nice and shiny and dark. Then with either a knife or a bread lom like I have, they work amazing, score the tops of the loaves however you like. Then pop them in the oven for between 25 and 30 minutes. If you're making one large loaf, 30 to 35 minutes, but if you're making like six little loaves, then check them about 20 minutes in. Might not be done, but good to check. You'll know when they're done when they sound hollow when you tap them, or if you have an instant read thermometer like I love, then just look for that 190 to 200 degree Fahrenheit read and that is when they are ready. So take the loaves out of the oven and let them cool on a wire rack. Now you don't want them to cool necessarily completely, but you're gonna be using your hands to pull out the inside, so you don't want them too hot. So now what we have here is a lovely little loaf of bread, perfect for, you know, one person or so, but it's not a restant. To get a restant, it takes a song.
You cut your restant, then you gut your restant. Mix the butter and crumbs in the butt of restant. Put the crown on and let it bake 5 more minutes. There, now you have your restant.
But seriously, all you have to do is cut the top of the bread off in the shape of a crown or whatever is easiest and pull out the insides. Then you're going to crumble them up into a bowl and pour melted butter over them. Then mix them together and restuff the loaf with them. You might not be able to get all the crumbs back in. It's a little bit like Tetris, but you can push them down. It's fine. Then put the top back on and pop it in the oven for 5 minutes. Now, if the loaf is already darkened quite a bit on top, you're going to want to tent it with some aluminum foil when you put it back in, just so it doesn't get too dark. After 5 minutes, you can do as the recipe says and serve it forth. So here we are, a restant fresh out of the oven. Let's give it a shot. I don't exactly know how to eat this. I don't know if you just pull out the insides or if you... It's too big to bite into, which I guess wouldn't be the case if it was smaller, but I'm going to just try the insides because that's where the buttery goodness is. So let's go. So buttery. I mean... Hey, first of all, not a pastry. Meh, niet. This is bread. And it's really good bread. Very flavorful. I think it's a good thing to use a little bit of the whole wheat flour, just kind of zhuzh it up a little bit, but really good. I wish that I had a steak to go with this, because this would be really good, like alongside a steak, because it's not a meal in and of itself. It's a little bit of work, but it's worth it. It's worth it. And it's kind of cool. I like the top, you know, it's cute. So like I said, the original recipe as well as the modernized version are in the description down below, as well as some links to the tools that I used and some of the ingredients as well. Anyway, make sure to hit that like button and I will see you next time on Tasting History. Yeah, I need a steak. Wish steakhouses were open.